need to bring economics to 21st century. Take a look at the inspiring, wonderful Kate Raworth.
Not from the benevolence of the butcher, the brewer, and the baker that we expect our dinner, but it is from their regard to their own interest. So they weren't being generous in providing our beer and our bread and our bacon, they were responding to prices. Fair enough. Adam Smith was 43 years old when he wrote this book. He actually didn't have a wife, he didn't have children, so he wasn't, again, our life experiences show what we do and don't notice. He was living with his mum when he wrote this book. Now guess who was making his dinner every day? And just imagine if at that moment when he wrote this line, it is not from the benevolence of the butcher, the brewer, and the baker that we expect our dinner, that his mum, a woman called Margaret Douglas, if she'd said, Adam, dinner's on the table! He might at that moment have had this insight, said, my God, it depends not only on the market, my dinner, it depends on the unpaid care of my mother. He could have invented feminist economics in 1776, but he didn't. But it's a really important question you raise, because it's the relationship between these different forms of provisioning, between the market and the state, between the market and the household, between the state and the commons. All of them are fundamentally valuable forms of provisioning for our well-being. Where are they? Let me put them up here. There they are, right? All of these forms of provisioning are fundamental. And in many countries, particularly, and I know not so much here in Finland, I know you have a large role of the state, but in the UK and the US, what we've witnessed for 40 years is encroachment of the market on the household, squeezing the commons, patenting common knowledge, and almost like a self-hating state that has minimized its role and sold off railways, sold off the postal service, about to sell off the health service. And I think it's to the detriment of people's well-being. So we need to see a rebalancing between all of those and respecting the role of the household at that fundamental level of providing for human well-being that never shows up in markets and prices, but is fundamental to each of our well-being. They say back to me, yes, there are some problems in the world, but we don't need these new economic ideas. We have all the tools already to do this. I just personally believe the framing and the tools are out of date. And if last century's economists were alive today, because they're very clever people, if they were alive today and they saw this challenge, they would draw up new theories too, and they'd go, what? You're still using an idea I wrote down 150 years ago? Do you have no ideas of your own? So yes, I get the mainstream critique, but also whether it's framed as a Marxist critique or certainly bringing in power. And I'll often say when presenting this, there is power across every one of those lines. There is a power relationship. Yeah. And we have to talk about it. We have to put it into economics. So you brought up the perfect example. I'm talking about distributed economy. And it's absolutely right that you say, but hang on, you're making it sound like distributed economy is going to be more equal. Right now, we have an information network economy that's been captured by Google, Facebook, Twitter, Uber. How are we going to resolve that? To me, this is like phase two of the internet. Phase one was, it was a few scientists online saying there's everything is free here, there's no markets, it's collaborative. Phase two, the big boys came in and said, forget that, right? We're going to take this over. And the network effect means if you are big enough, fast enough, you capture the whole network. And I think publics around the world are waking up to the privacy implications of that. And I think we're going to go into a phase three. But I'm glad for your point, because power is everywhere. And just because I draw a nice donut that looks like a better world, it doesn't mean power relationships go away. It doesn't mean corruption will go away. It doesn't mean that struggle between these relations will disappear. It won't. But we need to put it into economics and talk about it. We definitely need, I think, regulation and the design of industry to make that work better. So we need governments to require textile manufacturers, for example, to reuse textiles, to change the rules about sourcing and dumping of old textiles so that it becomes a circular design. So yes, it's going to come from there. Yes, I think it needs to change in academia. And what I focused on in my book was to talk about the way we need to change the fundamental ideas that are taught in economics. But it's only one tiny piece of a much, much bigger jigsaw. And yes, we need to see the change coming from what people choose to be part of, the aspiration. A younger generation wants to own a Fairphone, not an iPhone. They want to use a shared car, not own a car. People want to have a solar panel, not coal-powered electricity. There is a transformative mindset that's going along with this. But all of these, I think, depend upon each other. There's no sitting back and waiting for one of them to lead.